Hello, I'm Senator Leroy Comrie. Welcome to another edition of Comrie's Corner, your inside look at government here in our great state capital in Albany. Today, I'm pleased to have with us Richard Berkley, Executive Director of the New York Utility Law Project. Thank you for coming this morning, Richard.
Thank you, Senator. It's a great pleasure.
Thank you for being our guest. Please tell us a little bit about yourself and your background. And I understand you spent some time working in the New York State Senate before you became Director of the Law Project.
That's true, Senator. It feels like I just can't get away. I spent 4 years working for Senator Parker. At one point, I was the Executive Director of the Senate Energy and Telecommunications Committee. After that, I was counsel to the Majority Whip and a few other things.
Okay.
And what I do now as Executive Director is I run the Public Utility Law Project of New York. We're a 35-year-old public interest law firm. We're a not-for-profit. We have a unique mission in the state. Our mission is to educate, advocate, and litigate on behalf of low and fixed income utility consumers.
Excellent. Educate, advocate, and litigate. Are you
Yes.
doing all three areas? That's good. What prompted you to enter into the field of energy, and how did you find your way to the Public Utility Law Project as a result?
Well, it's a very long story, like all the good ones are, so let me just cut to the newest parts of it.
Okay.
When I first started working for the state legislature, I was counsel to Assemblyman Richard Brodsky in the Assembly. And among other things, his committee had jurisdiction over the Public Service Commission and all of the energy, telephone, and cable utilities. And I found I really liked that. So
the law project, is it funded by the Public Service Commission or is it separately funded?
We are actually funded primarily by the state legislature for a bunch of reasons. One of them is we were created 35 years ago in the aftermath of what was called then the Arab oil embargo.
Mm.
And of course, the cost of electricity went up very dramatically in that time period. We were created to try and do something about that increase in cost for low and fixed income people. The legislature thought that that was an important mission, and so for 35 years, the legislature has provided us with a good bit of our funding.
I see. Well, that's interesting. What is the difference between the work that you do in the Public Utility Law Project and the Public Service Commission, which is also a state agency?
So the Public Service Commission has a statutory duty to regulate public utilities, and so used to include trolley cars and trains. Now it is limited to energy utilities and to telephone and cable utilities. And at some point, they will probably get back to doing something about broadband and water.
Mm.
What we do is, and so they operate on a statewide basis, and they are not really designed to advocate for individuals or, for that matter, to provide the public input into the making of the policy that they're working on. We, on the other hand, were constituted on purpose to be able to bring the public into those proceedings. And so when we come in front of the PSC, we say, on behalf of low and fixed income New Yorkers, so we're talking about seniors, we're talking about veterans who don't come back to the best situation, we're talking about the disabled, and obviously we're talking about people who make households that make $35,000 or less and pay more than a third of their income to utilities. And that's a lot of people in New York
State.
That's
a lot of people in New York
State. So we bring their voice into the proceeding. And we say, on behalf of these people, you, Public Service Commission, must do this, or you must do that. Or while you're thinking about this, you know, this merger, for example, Time Warner just merged with Charter Communications.
Mm.
We went into that proceeding and we said, Public Service Commission, you have to make sure that low-income households have the ability to get affordable high-speed broadband. Time Warner, up until then, didn't have a statewide product that was aimed solely at the low-income market.
Mm.
We asked the commission and the company to provide that, and now they do.
Now they do.
Yes.
Has the Charter and Time Warner Cable merger gone through yet?
It's gone through on the New York State level. California is still looking at it. The feds are going to approve it.
The feds are going to approve it. Okay.
Yeah.
But now you said you advocate, litigate, and you also represent the community and the public at large before the Public Service Commission.
Correct, sir.
And you also help go to court on behalf of consumers. Can you explain that a little bit?
Sure. We're actually originally constituted as a legal services agency, and so we used to get funding from the Legal Services Corporation in Washington.
Mm.
We're actually talking to some of the other legal aid and legal services organizations to try and find some good lawsuits to move forward with. And just to give you an example from a few years ago, because I know this issue is near and dear to your heart, in the city of Auburn, there was an individual whose name is Pilchin. and Ms. Pilchin was living in a building with an absentee landlord, not like anyone in New York City has ever heard of those.
Right.
But she was living in a building with an absentee landlord who decided to stop paying his water bills to the municipality.
Right.
And so the company had the municipality had decided, instead of doing what most municipalities do and tacking those unpaid water bills onto the taxes owed, they assumed that none of these people would come back even for the taxes.
Mm.
And so what they did is they shut the water off, in essence evicting everybody in the building. These were all low-income people. They had no other place that they could go in Auburn.
Right.
And so we jumped into that case in 2010, and we litigated that. I think it took us almost 3 years. We ended up winning a constitutional right to water in the state of New York. And unfortunately, as these things go, we won. Ms. Pilchin was able to get her water turned back on. A whole bunch of other people were benefited by that case.
Mm-hmm.
Fast forward now, 6 years later, some of the upstate municipalities have looked at that case. They've learned what they need to do to be able to get around it, and they're back to the same old behavior.
Really? So you mean an absentee landlord can still turn off or not pay utilities, and the utilities, instead of going after the landlords, will still go after the individuals that are residing in the building?
What the municipalities do now is, one of the things that the court found in the Pilchin case was that you had a constitutional right to process before your water was taken away by the municipality.
Right.
And there are a whole bunch of reasons why this was important. One of them is that unlike private water companies, which are regulated by the Public Service Commission and subject to the Home Energy Fair Practices Act, which actually also includes water, even though we talk about energy, it turns out that in the negotiation to pass the Home Energy Fair Practices Act 35 years ago, which my organization was instrumental in writing and getting passed, that we were unable to add municipalities to that back then.
So don't you find that most absentee landlords, once they not pay on one service, they're not paying on multiple services as well?
That's very true. And one of the things that that you should be thankful for, actually, on behalf of your constituents, is that in New York City, there is a piece of law called 7A of the Housing Court Act.
Mm.
And 7A allows the city to nominate a not-for-profit organization to take over a building where an absentee landlord is not doing any of this anymore.
Right,
that's
right.
Unique to New York City.
Right. That's only in New York City. I did
yes.
not realize that the 7A administrator is a part, major part of allowing tenants to take over the utilities of a building in absence of an active landlord. I didn't.
It's vitally important in New York City.
Right.
The rest of upstate, up until now, in part because they don't have dedicated housing courts like New York City does.
Mm.
Hasn't moved in that direction. Unfortunately, I can't talk at any length about this since I'm under an ethics ban not to talk about legislation.
Right. Well, we'll move to other topics. So, I wanted to talk about the automatic meter readers that are coming in now for both water and the other utilities. A lot of homeowners have found that their bills have skyrocketed mm-hmm. as a result of the AMRs being installed in their homes, and you know what they got for electrical or water or gas now. And even a gas utility, the bills are dramatically different. Can you explain why that's happening and what homeowners can do to try to, get their bills back to the original levels that they were before? And is it tied to usage or was it poor metering that was done?
That's a great question.
Yeah.
And let me try and take it piece by piece because it's unfortunately somewhat complicated. So I'm going to have to do a little bit of theorizing, and thank you for sending me that question in advance. I'm going to have my staff look it up, and we'll come back with a much more detailed answer for you.
Okay.
So it turns out that in the city of New York, since the late 1970s, the city has been working on water tunnel number 3, because
mm-hmm.
we have two that date back to 65 years ago
right.
and have never been maintained and have never been shut off for maintenance. So water tunnel number 3 was made a priority to complete within our lifetime, 2021, actually, by Mayor Bloomberg. And so he dedicated a great deal of money in the city budget, and as a result, to match that money, the city's, I forget what they call it now, it's not BWS, it's now under DEP in the city.
Right, DEP, right.
So the water department in the city has been raising the cost of water by slightly over 8% every year since the middle of the Bloomberg administration.
Right, right.
And so to the extent your constituents are looking at their water bills going up like that, they're absolutely right. Unfortunately, there's little that can be done about that because that pipe has to be completed.
Mm-hmm.
What should be going on is that there should be interveners, like my organization, intervening into the proceedings under which they're getting these increases and figuring out if there's a way to make some space for low-income households to be able to still be able to afford this. New York City's water is some of the cheapest in the state, but at the same time, if you're having trouble paying your bills, it doesn't matter if it's the cheapest if you still can't afford it.
Right.
So that's one piece of the answer. The second piece is that for most households in the city up until, I think, about 15 years ago, water usage was measured by something called a block front. And so the size of the front of the building was used to create a formula that under which you were billed with a sort of imputed amount of water usage to you.
Okay.
But the city started transferring everybody over to water bills starting about 2001, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And so as you get to the new meters, in theory, your amount should have gone down. That was what they said when I changed mine back when I was living in the city back then.
Right.
In fact, my usage went up. But if you don't move to the new meters, you get billed at a much larger new rate for people without a meter. And for me, that was something like $1,000 a month, which is crazy. I wasn't, you know, running a car wash on my property.
Right. That's what you would think at that kind of rate. But so the rates are going up due to the increase in the water tunnel costs, the increase in the maintenance costs, and actual usage over estimated usage, because now they have the direct meters that are, and the new meters all measure actual usage. They don't measure.
They're supposed to all measure actual usage. If your constituents believe that the meters are running fast, they can file a complaint to the Public Service Commission, and I'll give your staff all the 800 numbers and everything that they need to be able to give your constituents to make those complaints.
Right. And you can track the rate of a new meter yourself. An individual consumer can look at the new meter and be able to, like the old meters, you could look at it and send it in and see what the rate was from the amount of usage on the meter from month to month. Can you do that for the new automatic meter readers?
You can still read the usage, but it's getting harder because you don't see the analog meter as the little dial went around.
Right.
The new ones, it's just a number changing, and so it's harder for you to figure out if it's running fast. But if your usage seems to be larger than anybody else's on your street, and this is where I think the fact, in particular, that your district has a lot of very tight neighborhoods where people know their neighbors.
Right.
They go to the same churches, they go to all the same events. Your constituents should talk to each other and say, gee, you know, with my new water meter, I seem to be using four times as much as I did before.
Right.
How are you doing? And then you just call in with a complaint. The company will send an auditor to look at it.
Mm.
It's entirely possible there may be a leak somewhere, but the only way to find that out is to complain and get the PSC involved, and they'll get the company involved.
Great. Well, thank you. I read a lot about what your agency is doing, and you started talking about a couple of issues, but can you explain what the Home Energy Fair Practices Act is and why that's important to homeowners and consumers in general?
Absolutely. The Home Energy Fair Practices Act, as I said, is a 35-year-old, incredibly significant piece of law in New York State. It's Article 2 of the Public Service Law, and it is the Utility Consumer's Bill of Rights for the state of New York.
Mm.
And it is so pathbreaking that many of the other states copied our law. So what it does is it creates a set of rights that every utility consumer in the state has with regard to their company and their billing. So for example, I'm sure from time to time your constituent relations people get a call from one of your constituents who says, I have a medical device, it has to be on all the time,
mm-hmm.
my bill is too high for me to pay, and the company is telling me they're going to shut me off.
Mm.
You have rights in that circumstance.
Right.
And so the rights, for example, the company can't just turn off someone with a serious medical condition with a medical device. There's a process they must go through. If they don't go through the process, they're breaking the law. They can be fined.
Mm.
If you have medically fragile children in your household, same thing.
Right.
So that's what the Home Energy Fair Practices Act does. And that's actually one of our large areas of filing complaints of the PSC, bringing administrative litigation, arises from violations of the Home Energy Fair Practices Act.
Right. Well, finally, there's a lot of questions that I can ask you, but we're running out of time. Do you have an 800 number, and how does the consumer get in contact with your office?
We do have a website, obviously, okay. utilityproject.org. We have a Facebook site where you can also find out information for us.
Yeah. Now we can get you in contact with Richard Berkley, the Executive Director of the New York State Public Utility Law Project. Thank you for coming in today. It's been very enlightening. I haven't even touched the surface of what other issues that we could talk about. But clearly, there's a lot that consumers need to utilize to reach out to you and know that you're there. The Public Service Commission that we've been talking with has limitations that your office doesn't have. I'm pleased to know that you're litigate on behalf of consumers as well, and I look forward to making sure that you are in the district in a large way so that our consumers and homeowners and everyone who uses the utility can know about your services. So again, thank you for coming and spending some time with us here today to enlighten our constituents about what you do here in Albany and what you do throughout the state. Thank you, Richard, for being here this
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you.